but don't expect to get anything. It's the exception that usually comes back that they would say they would cover it. So people do have to pay for it, and I'll get into what the costs are later, at least what we charge about privacy. So when I say that, you know, really zero long-term side effects, that truly is a key thing, because we just don't have many medications that are doing what this is doing for no risk. And most of the time, the medications that are coming out these days are the new ones. They're thousands and thousands of dollars. And, you know, if insurance doesn't pay for it, well, there's no way that you can afford to do it. This is still, for the vast majority of people, very affordable. Any luck yet?
Not yet.
Okay. So, one of the things that, so what do we use this medication for then? Probably the number one thing that people are using it for is pain, okay? Many people have pain, be it arthritis pain, be it nerve pain, whatever. Number two, any autoimmune condition. And autoimmune diseases are rampant right now. And it's unfortunate because young people, we comment in the pharmacy all the time here. When we were kids going to school, I hardly knew anybody that had to take a medication. Now, it's the exception almost. More and more young people are needing medications, and so many of them are needing it for autoimmune things. And I'll just give you a little brief thing on autoimmune. The term autoimmune means that your body is attacking itself. And all of that comes from, it's a gut issue. Our gut become what we call hyperpermeability, or permeable, or leaky gut. Has anybody heard the term leaky gut? And so just kind of looking at that, how does that happen? If you think of your intestinal lining as a strainer that you use, you know, when you're cooking. What do we use a strainer for? We use a strainer to strain out solids so that you just have the liquid going through. Well, our gut is similar to that. And we only want, after the food particle is all broken down into, you know, your protein, carbohydrates, and fats, and it's broken down to the smallest level so that it can go through and get absorbed into the bloodstream now. Well, now if we have a little hole in our strainer, what happens? Well, a little bit of food can get through that hole. It's not just liquid anymore. Same thing happens in our intestinal lining. There gets to be a little bit of a bigger space, and now a little bit bigger particle gets through and now gets into the bloodstream. Well, it's never been there before. And so our immune systems are very astute to this and say, oh, we've got a foreign material, we have to go after that and get it. And it exasperates into various disease conditions, rheumatoid arthritis, psoriasis, there's scleroderma, I mean, there's a ton of different, in your handout here, there will be, all these different conditions along the side there. And it just seems like there is a tone. So anyway, we have the body attacking itself. So why, how do we get that hold then in our strainer, in our gut lining? And we don't know fully. One of the big things, though, that we do know is the chemicals in our food. You know, our grandparents, when they ate, they had almost everything from the garden that was canned. And their meat was all, you know, their own pasture-raised stuff. There was never chemical additives added to that. After World War II, all of those things became much more prevalent. Can't get it?
Mm-hmm. Nope.
Okay.
No luck.
Okay. what we'll do
the
then.
The computer is by you if you.
Yeah, yeah, I'm just gonna say that's, yeah. That'll just help me go.
And you can maybe even put it up front, so you might be able to see it.
Yeah, for a little bit anyway. Which one is it for the moving the slides? That one. Okay. Perfect. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if, so I'll just finish mm-hmm. up what I was saying there in regards to the food thing. And then another thing, and I think this is a big thing, but we don't usually hear about it, and that is the advent of oral antibiotics. When I was a kid, first of all, we didn't go to the doctor very often. And if we did and we needed something, an antibiotic, we got a shot of penicillin in the butt, okay? Mm-hmm. And very seldom did you go back a second time because you didn't want to get a shot. And you usually started to feel better. In the 70s and 80s was the advent of the oral antibiotics. So when he got a shot, that went into the muscle, and then from the muscle into the blood and went throughout your body and did its duty of where it ever needed to get to. Well, we came out with the oral antibiotics because it was much more feasible, or the compliance was much, much better if you could take something by mouth. Because if you're supposed to come back, a lot of people didn't want to come back and get that shot. So taking something by mouth, easy. But what we didn't realize at that time is whenever we take an oral antibiotic, it affects the microbiome of our gut. And the microbiome, that's the balance of the good and bad bacteria, that makes up our immune system. And when we take an antibiotic, that's destroying some of our good bacteria. It hasn't been until the last probably 5 years or so that the traditional medical community starts saying that probiotics are good. I mean, Steve has had probiotics since he opened the pharmacy 20 years ago, but traditional Western medicine was never on board with that. But replacing those good bacteria help the microbiome. And I just feel that we give away way, way too many oral antibiotics. Now that's Steve Merrick speaking. It's not something that you're going to find in the literature, but I think you will at some point. And so that just leads to all of these autoimmune conditions. And so, and that's what this is trying to help with. So, I went through a little bit of the history now of the naltrexone, saying that it got its patent in 67, came out in 84. For the opioids, then also got approved for alcoholism for people, so helping with the addiction. One of the key people, Dr. Bahari, was the one who realized that it had a whole different effect on low doses when he was using it for treating AIDS patients in the 1980s. And this is the big thing. His discovery was that 1% of the normal dose, 1/100th, as I said before, had a paradoxical effect that increased the endorphin levels in your body by 300%. So endorphins are those feel-good hormones that you get, like when you exercise, when you laugh, when you eat chocolate. But not only do they make you feel happy, and a pleasant feeling, they also have healing properties. And that's where we get into the effects here of the naltrexone. So how we got started with making this a bigger deal was Steve Anderson went in June to a conference on LDN, because we've just been hearing more and more of it. And so there was conference from it's called the LDN Trust .org,
Research Trust.
Research Trust, yeah. And it's a international what do we call it?
Our organization,
probably.
It's nonprofit.
Yeah. It's a nonprofit. So all the speakers that were there spoke for nothing. You know, there were no honorariums paid. They just want to help promote the use of this because it's doing so well. So Steve, along with one of the local doctors here, went to the conference in June. And when he was there, he met Dr. Yazo. Dr. Yazo was one of the speakers, and he happened to be from Madison, Wisconsin. And Steve talked to him after the conference, and he said, you know what? You know, I come up to Minnesota. I have a brother who is a physician at the University of Minnesota, and I have a daughter who lives there. I'll just come up and talk to you guys. And that's how we got started. And Dr. Yazo has been here a couple times now and has helped talk to some of the physicians in the area and stuff. And he's a leading speaker and did a lot of the research. And when I say research, it wasn't that he was doing lab studies, but he was looking at collaborating studies of how this was working with people and looking at the different dosages and different disease states and stuff like that. So he's put a lot of protocols and stuff together. So that kind of all started down just of June of this past year, so like 8 months ago or so. So here we got into the mechanism of action, where we're talking about the LDN increasing the, blocking the opioid receptors, and that's still what it does. So, you know, we have to be careful with anybody who is on opioids. It doesn't mean you can't take them, and sometimes we have people who are taking it to get off of opioids. We have this opioid drug crisis out there. This can be one of the things used to help people get off of opioids, but it's a whole different way of how we have to dose for people like that, because it can block that receptor, and now if they're still taking opioids and they need to for pain, they're not going to get that pain relief. And so we have to go at it a little bit different way. Here we were just talking about increasing the endorphin levels and stuff. And then, you know, it stimulates mucosal healing, because a lot of people will take this for, like I said, gut issues, because so many of the autoimmune things are gut issues. And this can actually promote the healing. So those increased endorphin levels not only decrease inflammation, but they also can actually help heal. So in your one pamphlet and stuff like that, there's a whole list of different conditions. So I'm not going to go through all of them, but it just has here a sample of conditions that have been studied for use with the low-dose Naltrex. So what I do kind of want to highlight, and this won't be in your thing, is there is a pharmacy in Florida who was starting this low-dose naltrexone, doing more of it years ago already. And so they took data from 3 years of patients taking it, and then collaborated, and they asked patients, okay, you need to be at least 80% compliant with this, and we want you to take it for 3 years. And then they use the data then to come up with their own conclusion of how effective was the low-dose naltrexone in their disease states. So they did 5 different disease states. They did rheumatoid arthritis, an autoimmune thing. They did fibromyalgia. They did irritable bowel, ALS, which is Lou Gehrig's, and MS, multiple sclerosis, those 5 things. So they had a total of 2,435 patients. So that's a fairly good sample size over the course of 3 years. So here's a breakdown, it's kind of a pie chart. The most people were MS with 774, then they had fibromyalgia, irritable bowel, rheumatoid arthritis, and just a small percentage of people with ALS. So now this is kind of a bar graph that just shows of how effective it was from the start. So people had to kind of rate their symptoms, and on a scale of like from 0 to 5 at the start and when they were finished. So 2.5 down to 0.5, that was for people with rheumatoid arthritis. And that was pain, and these are other symptoms with rheumatoid arthritis. 4.1 to 1.5. Very, very dramatic. Fibromyalgia, this was pain. A 4.3 to a 2.2, so about half. Other symptoms with fibro. 3.3 to 1.1, less than half. Now we go over to IBS. 1.2 to 0.065. So a fairly big drop there. And other symptoms. A lot of people don't have pain, but they'll have other symptoms. But still a dramatic difference there in the irritable bowel. MS, 1.6 to 0.6. And then the last one, ALS, 2.6 to 0.45. And that was other symptoms with ALS, 4.4 to 2.8. Not quite half on that one. But most of them are over half. So overall, for 3 years on those 2,400 and some patients, 84% had improvement. That is really very, very remarkable. I don't know of other meds that are out there that have had that good of a success rate there. So that's kind of a take-home point. But this is the thing. Not everybody is that successful. And one of the key things is one, being in tune with your own body, and two, having interaction with us, the pharmacy. Because they also determined that if you just got a prescription from your doctor, a lot of times 4.5 milligrams is the number one dose out there that's prescribed, and you take it and you take it for a month, 2 months, that success rate went down to 25%. Or I should say, it starts at 25%, and with interaction with the pharmacy and stuff, if we can get it up to 84% by talking to you and also encouraging you not to give up. And I say that because for many people, they won't notice results for a couple months. And they'll think that it hasn't worked. I had a neighbor who had very bad neuropathy, and he took it for 6 months and was ready to give up. And I said, you know, let's try for another 3 months. We'll give him another 3 month prescription. And then all of a sudden, it was remarkable for him. And he noticed it about halfway through. His wife accidentally didn't put his medications once a day at bedtime for him. Then he had a little pill thing for the week, and she put it in at the bedtime and forgot. And he was remarkably worse. He said it was dramatic and didn't know why, but then a couple days later, then his wife realized that when she was filling his container the next time, she had forgot to put in his naltrexone that time. And within a week, he could notice a big difference. And within a week, he was back to being better again. So point is, the interaction with us in the pharmacy is a key thing, and to hang in there. We say, give it at least 6 months. Some people may notice something right away that first month, sometimes the first week, but most people don't. And so, doesn't mean it's not working. It's working behind the scenes, and you just have to give it time. This is just looking at some of the things here, the side effects. Of those people in that study, those 2,400 people, 87% had no side effect, okay? 12% had insomnia, okay? So difficulty sleeping. Part of that is, and I say there, when I was talking before, it doesn't have any long-term negative side effects. I say long-term. There can be things on the short-term, okay? One of the things is vivid or weird dreams, and they can possibly cause some insomnia for people. More often than not, they resolve within the first 2 weeks. Here it had resolution within 4 days was average. So I don't look at that as a real bad thing because it usually goes away. If it doesn't, instead of taking it at night, we can possibly take it in the day. That's another way of doing it. But it's just bizarre. You know, why would you get the weird dreams? It has to do with that increase of endorphins and your REM sleep at night. But some people do about, here at 12%. Dr. Yazo threw out the term 20% at one time. So vivid dreams here, he has 9% reduction within 2 days average. I think that 2 days is a little bit early. Dr. Yazo talked more about 2 weeks, and I think that's probably more accurate there. Headache, 3%. So this is the other thing I say, weird dreams that can cause some sleep disturbances, the number one thing that can be on the short term. Number two thing is we call them just some detoxifying symptoms. Has anybody taken some things like herbals or something to detox their body? Okay? Most people probably have it, but some do. Whenever you take something to detox your body, you can have some negative effects. Number one, usually is headaches. You can have increased headaches when you do that. Number two, some GI effects, typically diarrhea. And number three, probably some flu-like symptoms where you're just achy, the malaise feeling, you have no energy, you just don't want to do anything for it. And usually these only last for a couple days. And we tell these, call us. Again, some people say, oh, I feel sick on this, I'm not going to take it. No, that's not it. You call us and we'll step you through. Either we're going to stop it for a couple of days, but most of the time we don't stop it. We just say, let's lower your dose, and that will usually do it. Most people don't have a problem with the detoxifying effects, but then there are some segments that have a big problem. Lyme disease people who have problems with an active Lyme case right now, almost all the time they have problems, and we have to go lower on their dose. But the majority of people do not. But overall, extremely good side effect profile. And like I said, the ones that do pop up typically are short term and they're gone in 2 weeks, where by far the majority of people. Okay, how long has it been out there? It's been widely used for 40 years at much higher doses. Okay, so it's been out there for 40 years for the people who have done the higher doses of naltrexone for the opioid stuff. According to the National Institute of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, so we just put this slide in there, just shows that one of the organizations that deals with alcohol and stuff like that says naltrexone is not addictive, because we will get that question, especially people who are on pain medications or have pain and don't want to go on a pain medication because they're worried about, is it going to be addictive? Yes, they want to get rid of their pain, but two, they don't want to have something that causes an addiction for them. And no, it does not have any addictive qualities there, so you can stop it easily. And actually, we actually use it to treat addictions and people with obsessive compulsive disorders. Dosing. This is a big thing. We do not know when you start off what your best dose is going to be. And so we have some general things for that. We know that for people with the nerve pain, more than likely they're probably going to need to be on a higher dose, that 3 to 4.5 milligrams. Possibly even more than once a day if it doesn't do it initially. We know that people with the anxiety and depression, overall, they do better on lower doses, but twice a day. So 1 to 2 milligrams in the morning and 1 to 2 milligrams at bedtime. So there are some generalizations there. But I tell people, this is where you come in. We ask that you kind of be as astute as you can and try to list like your most troublesome symptoms that you are having, be it pain, be it sleep, be it energy during the day, be it GI effects, whatever it is. Try to just, you know, write down every couple days or at least once a week, how are you feeling? And rank it on a scale of 0 to 3 or 0 to 10, whatever, of how you are feeling. because then we can look at where you're at, and a lot of times we will titrate. Titrate means to adjust up or down based on what you're going to need to get to your best dose. So we have, a lot of times we'll start at 0.5 milligrams, and we go up by 0.5 every 2 weeks. And we do that so that you have a chance, your body has a chance to acclimate at a dose, and you get to see, okay, is this doing anything? If not, we're going to increase it. And then we'll probably get to 4.5. And at 4.5, you still might not have noticed anything for what you're trying to treat. But then we're going to probably stay at that dose for a while. But that's where the interaction with us comes in and stuff. So the big thing is, I tell people, it's more like the puzzle piece. You know, when we're dosing antibiotics, we know that amoxicillin 250 and amoxicillin 500, 500 is twice as strong as the 250. Well, here, the 4.5 milligram isn't three times stronger than the 1.5. It has, you know, three times more naltrexone in there, but it's not 3.5, three times stronger. It is just, is this the right puzzle piece that you need for your body, for your condition? And you are going to be different than the next person. And again, there's some generalizations, but it's very specific. That's true why this isn't being done by the drug companies, because it doesn't fit the masses. This is much more individualized therapy, and it works for compounding pharmacies, not for the traditional drug companies. We have gone up to 6 milligrams, and I think we even have had one at 9 milligrams. I don't remember really if that person stays at that.
And then they came back.
And they came back down.
It did well, and then they came back.
But for most of the time, we go up to 4.5, and then we kind of just stay there. But we can go up to 6, and we just try to work with you. Let's see. This was just saying we use the ultra-low dosing. Like for people who want to get off of opioids, that's when we use that 1 microgram. And we only have a couple people on that right now. That's a whole different protocol for people. Collaboration triad says physician, patient, and pharmacist. That's the big thing for our compounding pharmacy. That's what makes us different. For us to exist as a compounding pharmacy, we have to have an individual prescription for an individual patient. We can't compound things like the drug companies can make, you know, masses of, you know, an antibiotic, and then they get sent out to all the pharmacies and they're on the pharmacy shelves, but there's no patient attached to that. You eventually get a prescription, but it's made for the masses. And when it's made, it's not made for an individual patient, it's made for masses. For us, for compounding, we have to make it for the individual patient. That's what separates us out. And that's why we're still able to compound. So it's looking at that relationship between the physician, the patient, and the pharmacy. We have provider education. So you guys got a book or a 3-ring binder, and we have one for patients, and then we have one for the providers that, you know, we had here before. That's just a little more in detail. Then, did we bring out any of the LVN books? We have these, and they're for sale. We just sell them at our cost, which is like $15, if anybody wants one. They are very good. I haven't read everything, I have to be honest. Annie or Steve, have you read through it, Al?
Not though.
No.
Okay. But for the most part, it's not over your head reading. And it's very good. So these books are excellent, excellent resources too. There's an LDN app for people who want to track their symptoms and stuff on their phone. They're into the technology. Like I said, I'm over 60, so I don't do that, and I have no interest, but it's available. Annie, I don't remember those popping up before. That's all part of that app, okay. What our patients have said. So I had, you know, given you an example from our neighbor. Annie, do you have an example of some of the people?
Just a couple of, I guess, quotes that kind of stick with me. Just this week, a patient who had been on for 2 weeks said, "I just can't put my finger on it, but something's different." And then I had another patient say, "I don't want to say it's a miracle, but it's a miracle." So a lot of good testimonials.
Steve, how about you? What are some of the things that you?
Can't recall all of them.
I know.
I spoke to somebody yesterday. She had had scoliosis, so at age 13 she had surgery, and they put a rod in her back. It's like a foot and a half long, and it's in her neck straight like that. She said she'd had trouble ever since. It's been 30 years. So 30 years of discomfort and pain, and for years, lately, it's had to get a cortisone shot every 2 weeks, because that's as long as she can make it without the pain, and in the neck and hip too, because it's the issue that's going on. It's been 2 months, and she said she has no pain, and she hasn't had a shot, you know, in the 8 weeks, and she's feeling fantastic. So I mean, just early on, there can be some pretty amazing things, and I mean, literally, I've talked to we've talked to hundreds and hundreds, but I know there's literally a few that I talked to within the first day where they just said something significant. And it could have been like their brain just fog cleared that they didn't know they had, you know, they just said it was that's how bad the fog was. Or their pain just substantially decreased within, you know, hours of the first dose. And it happens. It's not rare, but it's a low percent of things as well too. But I mean, just different variations of that. So, Kareen?
I've been on for 2 years.
Yeah.
And I said the first 2 days after I took it, I'm like, can this really like be this?
Yeah.
I mean, is this like for real?
Yeah.
And like, yep, I talked to you, we're like, yep, that can happen.
Yeah.
And then the only thing I had for side effects was I had a stomach ache that woke me up a couple times for like 2 or 3 nights, and then it was gone. And then I was like, is this like really helping me? So I went off of it. And I went, whoa. Went right back on again. And I can't explain the feeling. For me, it was that I have 8 different things on that categories or on the sheet that's wrong with me. So it doesn't take everything away, but it is like it just does this to you. And it makes you be able to cope with things, and it was a life changer for me. And in fact, I'm here to pick up my prescription.
Okay, and again, as we're you know, there's new information and there's things evolving on this too, on the dosing and stuff too. So I know just with recent talks with you and just some comment, you know, that, you know, it's improved a lot. Could be, I would say we just have to look at some of the dosing. Look at the dosing you're taking and look at adjustments too. I mean, we're just finding out just some, you know, there's, you know, because we've, like Dr. Yazel, so that, you know, one of the docs and pretty much all the ones at that conference, because I asked them, I said, is there, after hearing all the things it's really doing underlying and just balancing and dressing and communicating with the systems, you know, is there any circumstance where you would believe that this wouldn't work for? And, you know, they said, no, in theory, no, it should be beneficial for all things, because it's not treating a condition, you know, it's...
I sleep better at night.
Yeah.
That is like one of the biggest things I found with it, and I cannot take sleep medication because I feel like I'm like hungover in
right,
the morning
yeah.
or whatever. I actually get a good night's sleep when I take this. So then
the majority of people
so refreshed the next
so
day.
Even though that insomnia
yeah.
can happen for some people, by far the majority say they sleep better.
And like a lot of times, like with my anxiety and stuff, I get really uptight. I'm just like mm-hmm. this. I'm just like, it just levels me out, I guess is the best way to describe it. I don't know.
Yeah.
Like,
and we hear that from the majority.
Yeah.
again, some of it is just, you know, getting the right dose.
I can't imagine going back to feeling the way I was before I was not on it, so. Can you just give me my prescription?
Very good, well, thank you.
Curious, do you build up a tolerance so you have to keep increasing the dose, or you don't?
No.
Okay.
No.
No. Sometimes we have to change, but we don't use the word tolerance.
Okay.
Let's see here. Evidence in pictures. Again, you're not gonna be able to see this real well, but this was a Crohn's disease person. Person with symptoms on the left, and then weeks or months later on the right. So it's kind of hard to see that here. This was ulcerative colitis. This one you can probably see a little bit better. There's kind of like a lot of white and, you know, almost looks like pussy stuff there. No, it's not pus, but, and then this one, it's all nice and healed for that. So people with GI things greatly benefit. That's one of the bigger things that we see benefits with. Psoriasis, this was a patient, a younger person with psoriasis, the hand and fingers all peeling, and then afterwards virtually all healed up there. So psoriasis, like I said before, it's a gut issue. And this person has complex regional pain syndrome. very, very painful thing, and these people often are on lots of opioids, and their light condition before, very red, one's just very inflamed, and then this was months later, that was good. Person with another complex regional dystonia, where the foot is just curved, much less here. So, concluding, you know, there are a ton. It says about 20% of the U.S. population have autoimmune conditions. And so, and like I said, that's just huge. And then they're also looking at, okay, as Steve was saying before, is there anybody that can't or shouldn't be on it? As I said before, you know, we use caution with people on opioids. Probably the only segment of people that we have to say no, and that is people who have had transplants. It is not indicated because it could interfere with those anti-rejection meds that transplant people take. So at this point, that is a contraindication. But that probably is truly the only contraindication. Is that right? That, you know, that, otherwise, so then the question asks, well, can you use it as a prophylactic then to help prevent things? And, you know, there's not enough research out there to say yes, but I will say that there's enough indication that I would say, you know, I don't have a problem with people looking to do that. And I'm currently taking it just for that reason, to help prevent cancer. You know, one of the things that we didn't say on here, people with cancer have been able to take it and have had, again, I don't want to say it's a cancer cure because, you know, that sounds too good to be true there, but there are people who have had good results with it, with their cancer, even with pancreatic cancer. But it can help prevent those things. So I think it can be beneficial for people too, as a prophylactic, but we won't push it that way at this point yet. There's not enough evidence out there to probably say that. But and for pets, we can use it for pets too. And so there's a large segment of those. More and more people are having pets. So okay. So that's kind of the overall presentation. Now it's open to questions and stuff that you guys would have.
Just looking for some clarification. When you were talking about the testimonial, you said brain fog, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was lifted in a couple of days?
Because they're using it for, this is kind of just involved in the last year or two where they're really noticing the effect of that. Again, the reason why they didn't really notice it much before is because they're always just shooting for that 4.5 milligram dose, and for some reason, the brain effects don't follow when you get a little bit higher like that, even though it's, okay, 1 milligram to 4.5, I mean, it doesn't seem like it's, you know, that's much of a change, but they're finding that the lower doses touch on really all brain health, mental health things. So depression, anxiety, like autism, ADD, obsessive compulsive type things. It just helps with kind of the signaling and wiring and connections of the neurotransmitters in the brain. And plus, you know, it's taking out inflammation all over too. So if you really, you know, really if it really look at the whole picture of all that going on, there's inflammation going on that's creating problems in the whole body, and it affects the brain too. So in different ways. So yeah, I mean, it can fit in there with the focus and clarity. We have people, you know, it's just kind of overall, they're just, God, just feeling better and thinking better and more succinct with my thoughts. So somehow just it touches on, you know, the whole aspect of brain health, or it has that potential, you know, so.
We've both been struggling with Lyme disease. So when you were talking about how it might not come back around for us right away until you get the lower dosage.
On that too. So what's really evolving this with Dr. Yazel that was here, he's really kind of one of them behind the thing where they, you know, because what happened was what they noticed, and they finally started tying together on the dose and the effect is, you know, because we do it here, you know, I mean, that's kind of where we start lower too, because oftentimes when they start lower, and we heard it here a couple years ago before we really kind of knew this new research that came out, people would start low just because we figured, well, less side effects, and you just kind of ease in. Some people do better on lower, but they, you know, they'd come in and say, gosh, I haven't noticed anything in my pain yet, but I'm just feeling a lot better. Is this supposed to work on the mood? And we'd say, it's kind of working on serotonin and dopamine, you know, it has some aspects there, so that makes sense. But then when they got to the higher dose, they'd say, well, my pain's better now. And finally, you know, a few months later, you know, their pain started to get better. But then they said, I'm not really sleeping or not really feeling as good. My mood's not quite as good. And I'm kind of feeling anxious again and stuff like that. So, and at that time, you know, we weren't, this is before we went to the conference, you know, just kind of picked up some of these things. So, and we said, well, I don't know. I guess I can't explain that. But you know that's what they're finding out. So now we're starting to see what they call hybrid dosing. So they'll, you know, to get for that's chronic pain and some of the pain and the immune system things, you have to get up to, for most people, the higher dosing. You know, 3 to 4.5 or maybe even 6. To address the, you know, just the brain health scenario, if that's an issue, which, you know, who doesn't want to feel better? You know, they're throwing in a low dose in the morning, 0.5 or 1, and then that brings that back into play and stuff too. So you can, and plus again, actually in the overall picture for the immune system thing, that's still, it's still working on endorphins and it's still kicking up. That's why it's helping for the mood, but it still has, you know, it has its effect for pain and its immune modulating effects. So you're actually getting 2 doses a day that's hitting on the immune system. So. In theory, you know, that's gonna, and again, this is just within the last year or two, they've been doing this hybrid dosing. So in theory, that twice a day dosing is gonna, you know, should, you know, enhance the, you know, maybe the speed of which things get better, but, you know, just the, you know, the greater effect of it too is, you know, so we're starting to, you know, we're starting to hear early stages of that too, but we haven't had, in our place here, we haven't had a lot of people that have been on that hybrid dosing for
months.
It's been 3-4 months where we've really started to do that a little bit more. So we don't have a lot of feedback. But the preliminary things that we're hearing, it's, you know, people are just, you know, they're on the right track. You know, that's, you know, so the one thing about that, which is, I mean, it's you know, all that brain health, mental health thing, that's, you know, there's not a lot of success with that with traditional medicine. It takes a long time. I mean, and it's amazing that with this, within the first month or so, they're seeing dramatic results with that. I mean, that's kind of like the hardest thing, and that's actually with this that starts touching on it really early, you know. So So that's what we, you know, we're seeing too, it just, that part of it too, because it's still the overall picture. You got pain, you got your, it's your whole well-being is that, and it gives you hope, you know, too, because they'll come in and the people say, you know, it's like, well, my, I haven't noticed anything in my pain yet, but I feel better. And that's probably as important thing for everybody. So it keeps them, you know, they have the hope. So it's like, so there's no trouble being patient waiting for the pain thing, because they already know they're feeling better. So, you know, that's what's been helpful for us. So it gives a little ray of hope on things too. And just so they know, you know, so they're, it just, and again, I think it's just that hope helps. It always helps us. So.
One of the things I said I was going to talk about, which I didn't at the end, is okay, so what does it cost for people? And so it will vary. There's a couple factors that make a difference. The dose isn't, you know, if it's 0.5 to 4.5, we don't vary on the price for that. Well, what does is the quantity that we're going to be getting, is it a 1 month supply, 2 month, or 3 month supply? 3 months, you're going to have a better price break than a 1 month. Then the other thing, is it once a day for you, or is it twice a day? And is, if it's twice a day, is it the same dose, or is it two different doses? So for us in our pharmacy here, it can range from as low as $38 a month to probably $65 a month. So that's the range. So yes, it is an out-of-pocket expense, but we also know that for the vast majority of people, not everybody, but the vast majority, they would be able to afford this. And so that's the range.
Does it have any other drug interactions, like if you're taking other drugs, does it have side effects or anything?
Other than the opioids that we have to be worried about because it blocks that receptor, no. We do not know of anything at this point that is an interaction, other than, as I said, the anti-rejection meds, so we don't do that.
How many local physicians would you say are on board? How do you approach this?
That's an excellent, excellent question. So,
did you say the question
was? Oh, yes, thank you, I'm sorry. Question was, how many of the physicians locally here are on board, and or how do we approach our physician in order to do this? And so one of the things to do is give them, and we have some provider booklets, and ask them if they've heard of low-dose naltrexone. And if they say they have or have not, you know, what is your thoughts about it? And if they are at all receptive, we can give, you know, can give them a binder and have them call us. Because you just say, you know, I've been reading about this and it is something that I would like to try. And as far as I've read and as far as I've heard from other people, there is no real risk of not trying it. And so I would like to. If that person is reluctant, then I want you to call us, because we can put you in contact with some physicians that you could see.
And then do they leave the dosing up
to us? The ones that we work with quite a bit, we like that. We like to have the word titrate on there, because then we have the ability to adjust that dose, and they have given us the ability so that we don't call them every time, okay, we're need a new prescription because they're going from 0.5 to 1. We can just do that because we've taken a verbal order for them for all their patients. So they leave us. Not everybody is comfortable in doing that, and we understand that. So that's where we have to contact that physician, though, and on your behalf, and just say, you know, and in speaking to you, your patient, we would like to see if we could try, you know, increasing to this dose now or whatever. Say, you know, we've seen good results by doing this.
We do have a folder with that for the providers that has there's over 1200 PubMed articles and research papers on low-dose naltrexone the pamphlet there, what it lists, there's studies for all of those. I mean, not a huge wide scale, because there's no, you know, drug company and trillions of dollars to do it, but It's, there's, on all of those, you know, it's by Harvard, it's by Stanford, it's by Dartmouth, it's by these, and we have those copies, so that'll be in there, and we have, you know, the ones that aren't there, that we have them too, so we'll ship it on to them. There's particular ones that maybe work a little more, that are a little more targeted for their specialty, and so, and we, you know, we'll just peel out the ones that would fit there and get those to them.
PubMed studies?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with that term?
So, okay, you had a question then?
Yeah, how about kids in type 1 diabetes?
There is some, you know, use with that.
Okay.
So, again, there's not a huge study on it, but it you know, it fits, and I got a little information on that too. I can
talk to
you. I
don't know of anybody that we've done here yet.
Yeah, we haven't done it, you know,
But there are there's a study out there.
It's just, you know, it's just
because of mood.
Okay.
You know, just
that's true,
right? Because
But its effect is on, you know, it's working on the immune system, and it's working. It's really in, you know, so it's clearing up the opioid receptor. So kind of overall, in the end, it's just through different ways. It's enhancing the communication signaling between the different systems in the body, the immune system and the endocrine system. So thyroid, adrenal, pancreas, ovaries, testes, on that end too. So by enhancing the communication and signaling between that, you know, the body just starts to do a better job of what it was meant to do.
Yeah.
You know, it's things get kind of gummed up for whatever reason, and it's just starting, and so the signaling gets better and things get addressed like they're supposed to do. So it has effects on the pancreas and stuff. And I, more in the type 2 diabetic scenarios, it's working on, it ends up balancing out the insulin levels, and you know, which has effects, you know, on the blood sugar, and then inflammation, by inflammation taking it down. So there's some positive effects that it's had on, even in type 1, you know, diabetics too, that they're finding. No big research study, but just things that have been happening, and somebody looking at the biochemistry or the physiology, what's going on, and saying, well, that's because it's doing this, that's why they're seeing this. But I can, you know, touch base with me on that, and I'll track down just the you know, some of the science that they have on that. So.
Cool, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Yes.
So, if you're on medication for depression, do you still continue to take it with
you? Good question. So the question is, if you're on medication for anxiety, depression, do you still take that? Our usual thought is, yes, you continue. And then at some point, hopefully, though, you could possibly try to taper your medication off if you hopefully have starting to feel a more positive effect with the LDN. But you keep it going initially.
So same thing like with gabapentin, I did
yes.
it 3 times a day.
Correct. You wouldn't just stop that.
Okay.
No, you would bring the LDN on board, and then after you feel like you've had some positive effects, then we start decreasing out the other ones, gabapentin being one of them.
And so for the pain control, if you have breakthrough pain, like I usually would take like a tramadol.
Yeah.
It don't work for me anymore. Like.
Well, so we have to be careful with that. It's not that you can't, but we have to space it out probably by at least 4, but probably more like 6 hours.
Okay. And I also use CBD oil and medical cannabis. CBD oil during the day, then the cannabis at night, because it makes you so sleepy.
Yeah.
So
there would be,
those are okay.
Yeah, there'd be actually some synergy with that. It's kind of interesting, and I need to look into a little bit more on that too, but that conference in Portland, you know, it was 3 days, and they probably had 20 some practitioners presenting, and there's several other presentations were on CBD oil just straight up, and a number of the other practitioners in their talks, you know, on the LDN, how it fits too, they said, okay, other things you can do to enhance whatever the situation was to make it better, you know, CBD, you know, so for anxiety, and you know, so some of the mental health type things, yes, and then all the pain ones too there. And they went into some of the biochemistry and physiology of it too, and there's some overlap on the immune system where the LDN's working here, and the CBD or the you know, cannabis would be working on this angle, and actually like omega-3 fish oil, same thing, they kind of, that fits in a little different angle. We're working on inflammation, pain, immune system stuff too. So together, you know, there's kind of a synergistic effect on it, yeah. And so those are fine, yeah.
So turmeric would be okay? I mean, that's what I take for inflammation.
Yep, you can continue to do that. Yep.
Yep, turmeric's
a good one.
Turmeric's fine, so yeah.
Have you had any success with people with Ehlers Danlos?
Ehlers Danlos. Yes, we actually do have, do you have a particular patient?
Well, we have a number of patients for that, amongst other things, and they're starting to see small changes, more changes with their other conditions, and then, you know, some things coming on board, but I don't have a full success.
Ehlers Danlos is one of those ones that it's in your pamphlet, and then, yes.
So just so that hyper mobility and flexibility.
So do you have it, Ehlers yourself? Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
It is one of the rare ones, so.
Okay. Other questions? Anybody else?
So how long does it take to get a prescription once? Because I know I'm going to make an appointment after being with my physician, but.
For the majority of people, we have things made up enough. And so we can do the majority of people the same day.
Okay.
I won't promise that 100% because that.
I go to Williams and Tiger Care and they're so on board with it.
Yes,
they're
that is a clinic that is 100% on board.
That's why they told me to come here.
Yeah.
So.
So yeah, if the prescription came earlier in the day, easy, you know, if it comes in at 5, you
mm-hmm.
know, we.
It's
I mean, we'll, I mean, actually, I mean, well, if somebody comes in at 5, we'll stay and finish it up. So as long as we, you know, as a rule, as we get in so many calls for it, our goal is never out on
okay.
it, too, just because people are coming in, and a lot of them are coming in from out of town to
yeah.
local practitioners, too, so they're in the area, so we just want to make sure they get it.
Keeping in mind that we're trying to spend some time with each new LDN patient as a pharmacist, too, so. That takes a little bit extra time as
right.
well when you pop
there's like
try
a 20-minute consult type
well,
of thing that we try to do.
Would make sense when you're trying to.
But to tell you the truth, what you heard tonight, you know, is more than what we cover in our consult. But we try to, you know, talk about your individual condition
right.
a little bit
right.
more.
Right.
So.
You didn't mention anything about follow-up.
Say that again.
You didn't mention anything about follow-up, I don't think.
Oh, yeah. So the follow-up. So. One of the main reasons why we brought Annie aboard was just to follow up. Again, in order for this to work, you know, we have to have interaction with you. I said that. And so Annie is trying to follow up you know, after 2 weeks or after a month and see how we're doing. and we will continue that until you hopefully are at a dose that seems to be good for you. We want to follow up. We're not 100%, but that's our goal, is to be able to follow up with everybody, because that's a key thing. I always tell people, if we don't call, I want you to call us, though, and ask for us. Probably the biggest thing that differentiates our pharmacy from all other pharmacies is the access to talking to a pharmacist. For the people who have been here before, I think you can vouch for that you can always talk to one of us. That doesn't usually happen in other places there. So okay. Anything else?
So you have to get a prescription from your doctor to do this?
It is still a prescription item, so yes, we do have to get a prescription.
What if they refuse?
That's where I said, if your doctor does refuse, call us. And we can guide you to somebody else that will do it. And I say you don't have to feel guilty about that, because if you go to, if you break your arm, you have your regular family physician. If you break your arm, you're probably going to go to the orthopedic clinic because they specialize in that, correct? So you can go to somebody who specializes in hormones, or you can go to, in this case, somebody who's specializing in LDN, because it is not going to interact with those other things. So we don't have to
worried, and maybe your physician will be worried, but he doesn't have to be worried that it's going to screw up other medical conditions. And I do respect some physicians who are not on board with it, just because they're not familiar enough with it and they haven't been educated. And so for them to write something and be responsible for something they don't know, the majority won't want to do that. And I don't blame them for doing that. I wish they knew what we knew. If they did know what we knew, there would be no problem and they would gladly do it. Mm-hmm. But they don't. They don't know what we know. And so part of our thing is to educate them. And that's part of, if we can give them a three-ring binder, you can have them call us and talk to us about it. Those are things that may enhance that chance of them writing it.
So yeah, there's some, you know, 2 years ago, we had, this is probably when we started getting more practitioners at, and you know, so somewhere there's a 6, 8, 10 physicians in the area that we see a fair amount of prescriptions from, and 2 years ago there was none from them. So just a matter of awareness.
Yes.
You know, they said, yes, I'm willing to look at the studies and the research, and we presented it to them, and they read it and said, gosh, you know, why not? And they've gone forward. So it's just a matter of awareness is what it is.
I had a call today from a physician for the first time. That physician was seeing one of our employees, actually, and knows that the person is on it and has done well. And so she had a patient who thought, okay, she was having some pain and nothing was working, so maybe this could be beneficial. So that was a case there. Never had prescribed it before, but did call us then. We got them going.
So how do you know what to ask for, though, when you go to the doctor and you just say you want to start on this low dose? This?
Yes. That, and you ask the doctor, are you familiar with low-dose naltrexone? And if they say, nope, haven't heard of it, and they said, hey, I gave you some information on it, would you be acceptable to look at it? Because it's something that I feel strongly that I would like to try. And that's where you go. And if they say no, well, then there's nothing you can do. But if they say yes, then you can hand them, and we can give you a provider binder, and then just have them contact us. Or just have them call us.
So probably the best thing you could give, and this is our number one thing that we would give them on tab 3, there's a study in there, it's a review of studies actually, by Dartmouth University, and what they did is, at the time they did this, which was, what's the date on this, year and a half ago, they reviewed the 1,000 articles, or research studies articles, on PubMed, and they looked at 1,000 of them, they went through and selected out what they felt was the best 90 articles or studies on it, and wrote up this review on it. So this is a summary of all the best articles on it. So for any doctor, they don't have to go spend weeks and weeks researching and looking everything up. The Dartmouth, the professors and doctors at Dartmouth did it for them. So that's really the best thing that you can give any practitioner, because it lays out dosing and strategies, how they use it, different conditions and effects that they have on it too. So that's really,
because it comes from an Ivy League school, it's got more credibility and stuff like that. But it's not just.
I know some that just was diagnosed with cancer and going through chemo and radiation. Is this something that could help them?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because it will help heal the body too, right?
Correct.
Yeah. Actually, it's being used in conjunction with chemotherapy.
Right.
Yeah,
that
should make
the effects.
Now, that might be a tougher sell to the physician, again, because...
Depends on who it is.
Yep. They have to... There's not too many oncologists, unless if they're on board with it, that would just do it automatically, because...
again, education.
Yep. It's.
But that's where you have a secondary provider involved.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Because you are still in charge of your body. And that's what I try to encourage people.
Yeah.
You go to the physicians for their recommendations and things, but you, and only you, know your body better than anybody. And yes, they're experts in a lot of things, but you don't have to agree with every single thing.
Yeah. But it was, my father had cancer too, and it was discovered, it was pretty late, but you know, at that, you know, so at that point, we asked the practitioner, and they weren't aware of it, and my dad's a pharmacist, he liked the research and stuff, so he did all this stuff on it, and we just said, you know, he said, I don't know. It's like, well, why not? What have we got to lose? You told me I have 6 months to live. I mean, you know, what's the fear here? You know, what's, you know, why not? You know, at that point, I mean, you know, if there's, and if you look at the, you know, the literature on it and stuff like that too, there are studies and research and things on that. It's there. We have copies of the papers.
Make sure I pass this on.
Yeah, and again, if that's, you know, at that
so
point.
So you go to his primary physician, get the oncologist once he's
correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
And that why not philosophy is kind of with any condition. You know, we get asked all the time, like, could it help this? Could it help this? And there may not be a study on that condition, but we kind of have the attitude of,
why
not? Try and see.
Because again, that risk benefit. We just don't know of any risk at this point.
Why?
And so people think, okay, you know, when Dr. Yazel was here, he said, you know, in some aspects, that's one of the negative things about it is it can help so many things that people think is, okay, is this just snake oil that you're trying to sell here because it seems too good to be true? But when you look at how it's working by decreasing inflammation. Inflammation is the number one cause of disease states. And so if we're decreasing inflammation, it just does make sense that it's going to help on many, many different aspects. So.
So you said the only thing that one would be with like heart transplants or?
Any transplant, yes.
Knee transplants or
well,
heart only?
When you say a knee transplant, are you meaning a total knee?
Yeah.
Yes.
No, that's an okay thing because you're not, when you're taking
organs,
somebody else's
organ
and putting it in you, because you always have to take anti-rejection medications because it wasn't your own.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're on an anti-rejection medication, then we would say, no, you cannot take this.
Okay.
But if you're not on an anti-rejection medication, then you can.
Does it help with high blood pressure problems then too?
In the big picture, yes, just because it can help with decreasing inflammation. And so, you know, you're probably not going to see a direct indication to take LDN for lowering blood pressure. But overall, it can help with that aspect. Okay. And we'll be around here yet. If you want to ask some personal questions or anything, feel free to do so. But otherwise, those are for you to keep, and if you want more, we have them. Like I said before, this is how we get the word out, is from people contacting, you know, giving it to your friends and stuff like that.